Good morning. And a very warm welcome to our worship this morning at Mayfield, Salisbury Parish Church. Welcome to everyone who's here in person and to those who are online in the live stream, welcome to you too. I was going to say on this glorious sunny morning, anticipating that's what was going to happen, but of course somewhere the sun has disappeared this morning. But I hear rumours it'll be back this afternoon so we can enjoy it then. So welcome to everyone. And welcome as well to Ian McPherson playing for us this morning on the organ. It's great to have you back, Ian. Thank you for playing for us today. Everyone is most welcome to join together in fellowship for tea and coffee and refreshments after the service. This morning it's in the lower hall because the Edinburgh People's Theatre are in the hall as part of the church being a fringe venue. So the best way to access the lower hall, I think, would be to head instead of the door to my right, the door to my left, and down from that way into the lower hall. So please do come through, especially if this is not a place where you regularly worship and you may be here visiting family or as part of the festival and fringe. Do come through for conversation and refreshments afterwards. As I mentioned, the Edinburgh People's Theatre are here with their play Deals o' Waugh until Friday, I think. They're here for the rest of this week. Tickets still available. And the Festival of Sacred Arts is also ongoing around the city, and there's of course many other things going on in the festival that have a religious, a Christian flavour to them, as well as so many other things. You may be going to lots of different events, but keep an eye out for the Festival of Sacred Arts and others. Tonight, the youth group will have its kick-off session in the garden, weather permitting, from 6:15 till 8 o'clock for P6 to S6. So all young people very welcome there too, and other young people going back to school this week as well, so hope that all goes well for the young people that are part of our congregation too. If there are any youngsters with us this morning, there may not be with people away on holiday, etc., but there will be a Sunday school provision after the second hymn, and that will also be in the lower hall. You'll see in the back of the order of service there are several things to commend to you, just to have a browse and a look. You'll notice in particular number 10. Last year we had a very successful student welcome for new postgrads at New College at the Divinity School, and that was a great occasion of curry and conversation through which some lasting friendships and connections were made. So if you'd like to become part of that, either in being involved in the event or being at the event, or indeed potentially hosting a student and being a friendly link with a student during her or his time here, then please do get in touch with Alistair McGilchrist, and you'll see his details at number 10 at the back. So as we look forward, a brief look back as well. At the time of our joint services in July, our dear friend Alf Haney passed away in his 90s, and we didn't have the chance to mark that here in this church. I thought it might be appropriate just to mark that this morning. Alf had decades of service as a Sunday school leader, an elder, a member of numerous committees. He was a man of strong faith, and I know he was a much loved person here in this congregation over many decades and in the community. May Alf rest in peace, good and faithful servant of God. And to Alf's wife Sheila, his daughter Liz, and his son-in-law Alistair, and to all the family, may God be with you in these times, and may you know that Mayfield Salisbury will always hold a depth of love and of gratitude for Alf and for his life and all of his service here. As we thank God for Alf's life, today's service is focusing on life, on creation, on what it means to be human, to be made uniquely, and yet each one of us in the image and the likeness of God. We'll go through the service unannounced and worship together, but you'll notice perhaps a hymn that might not be familiar to you, the second one, God Made Me As I Am, that we'll sing together three times. It's a really simple tune. It's designed for young people, but all ages are welcome, of course, to enjoy it and sing it. So when we get to that second hymn in the service, Ian and I will do a once through, and then we'll stand to join together three times. As we gather for worship, Jesus Christ is present with us, bringing his love and his peace. Before we begin, shall we turn to those around us and offer them peace? May the peace of Christ be with you. See our words of the call to worship. In the beginning, God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and he separated the light from the darkness. In the beginning was life, and that life was the light of the world. And the darkness has never overcome the light. The true light that gives light and life to everyone has come into the world. God the Creator, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit are with us here and now as we worship. I think Ian has jumped slightly ahead of us, but that's good. That's the second time Ian, the God. No worries. Let's give it a practice now, will we? Since you're at the piano, let's do it. Okay. Before we have our first hymn, we'll still practice the second. Here we go. Ian and I will sing it through.
Yes, I am part of creation's plan. No one else can ever be the part of.
Try it with me. 1, 4, 5. We'll try it again, Ian. Okay.
God made me as I am, part of creation's plan. No one else can ever be the part of God's plan. That's me.
Excellent. We're all prepared for hymn number 2. Now let us worship God. We sing our first hymn, hymn number 4, How Excellent in All the Earth.
Thank you.
Opening prayer is partly adapted from John Bailey's A Diary of Private Prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, known as wisdom before the dawn of creation, Lord Jesus Christ, perfect love made flesh, Holy Spirit of God, ever present, in the beginning, you, the uncreated, moved across the face of the deep and brought out space and time, and then material substance, the atom and the molecule, then the first germ of life, and the long upward striving of all things that swim and creep and fly. And then the miracle of human intelligence and consciousness, the beginning of mystery, and the saying of the first prayer. Lord, forgive us for those times when we have taken this mystery for granted. And forgive us all the more for the times when we had thought we have fully unraveled the mystery, thought that we know it all, the how, the where, and the why. Why do you continue to bother, Creator God, when we are so certain that we can create life for ourselves? When we try to pretend that we aren't frightened of those who are different from us, that we aren't driven by our insecurities and our selfishness, that we aren't sometimes overwhelmed by life and its challenges. Why do you still come to us, God? Why do you send us your messengers? Why do you invite us from the heat of life into the cool water of your presence to be refreshed and cleansed and changed? Why do you embrace stables and crosses in your Son Jesus to offer yourself as shepherd to the lost sheep that we are? Somehow it seems, in ways that we may never understand, that you truly are a God of infinite grace. Somehow your judgment and your love are not opposites, but expressions of the same surprising reality, that you always seek to save, to restore us, to renew, that your forgiveness and your commandments together offer us a way to be fully alive. Help us, Lord, to hear your voice beyond the skittering thoughts of our minds and the buzz of everyday life. Help us to hear your voice in the cries of children, in the weariness of the sick, in the calls for justice of the dispossessed and the oppressed. May we hear and listen and respond to your voice in our lives and in our world. In Jesus' name we pray and bring to his words of prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. So sometimes when it's a really hot summer day, like some that we've had recently, and I'm feeling a bit overheated or tired of the sun, I picture that it's winter during Christmas time. I picture myself when I was a kid sled riding with my friends, my fingers and toes growing very cold over time. And we would often lay on our backs making snow angels with our mouths open to the sky, hoping to catch a few icy snowflakes on our tongues. As silly as it might sound, that can help me cool down when all else seems to fail, especially when you live in a country where air conditioning is very hard to find. So when I was growing up, I remember learning a fun fact about snowflakes, and I wonder if anyone knows what that is. Anyone know what's unique about snowflakes? Yes, you're exactly right. No two are the same. So I did my best efforts to make some paper snowflakes, and as you will know, if you've ever made a paper snowflake, even if you try to make one exactly the same as another one as well, it'll never happen. So had one here, and then this one here, which is totally different than the other one that I had. So even when you're trying to make one out of paper, it's pretty impossible to make it look exactly the same. I was always fascinated by the fact that snowflakes are different, because you would never know it unless you took the time to look at each one very closely, but they would often melt before you even got the chance. I learned that because a snowflake's shape evolves as it journeys through the air, no two will ever be the same. Even two flakes floating side by side will each be blown through different levels of humidity and vapor to create a shape that is truly unique. In one of our Bible readings this morning, we hear about how God created humans and how the humans were created in the image of God. All of these humans were created worthy of God's love because we all carry God's image with us. Yet at the same time, we are like snowflakes, each unique, growing, and shaped in different ways. Now, I know the term snowflake may have been used in a derogatory sense or a negative way in recent years, but if we put that thought aside, I think the image and formation of a snowflake is a powerful one when we think about our own unique creation. We are all different in so many ways, but equal in God's eyes. We are unique because of the countries we come from, the parents we have, the color of our skin, where we go to school, the language we speak, our abilities and disabilities, what we do for a living, what our natural talents and gifts are, the list could go on and on. We are unique because we have all grown up with different life circumstances and experiences that have blown us around, like a snowflake, to shape and form us in very unique ways. And even though we are all different from each other, the thing that binds us together, making us equal, is the fact that each one of us has been created in the image of God. This is important because it reminds us that no matter how different we are from our neighbors, nothing can separate them or us from the love of God. We are all worthy of God's love, and we have all been tasked with looking after the world and all of God's people, to look out for those who are being treated unfairly or unkindly, and we've been given this responsibility to care for one another and to care for the rest of God's creation, using all those unique talents and gifts, perspectives, and life experiences that help us make the world a better place. So may we all appreciate the snowflake we have been created to be, seeing it as a very, very beautiful thing. May we remember that we have all been created in the image of God. May we be mindful of how we are being called to love and care for others to make the world a more just and equal place. Amen.
young people with us who would like to go through, you're very welcome, or of course welcome to stay.
First reading is Psalm 8, Divine Majesty and Human Dignity. O Lord, our Sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouths of babes and infants, you have founded a bulwark because of your foes, to silence the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you have established, what are human beings that you are mindful of them, mortals that you care for them? Yet you have made them a little lower than God and crowned them with glory and honor. You have given them dominion over the works of your hands and have put all things under their feet, all sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, the birds of the air, and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the seas. O Lord, our Sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. And Genesis chapter 1, 24 to 31. And God said, let the earth bring forth living creatures of every kind, cattle and creeping things, and wild animals of the earth of every kind. And it was so. God made the wild animals of the earth of every kind, and the cattle of every kind, and everything that creeps upon the ground of every kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the wild animals of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth. So God created humankind in his image. In the image of God he created them, male and female he created them. God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves upon the earth. God said, see, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is on the face of the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the air, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food. And so it was so. God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. Amen. And may God bless these readings of his holy word.
Thank you. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing to you, Lord God, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, we are, of course, in the midst of the amazing variety and hullabaloo of the festival and the fringe. And at its end is the annual prize for the best one-liner by a comedian. There have been some corny ones in the past, like Tim Vine's, "I've decided to sell my Hoover. Well, it was just gathering dust." And Ken Cheng's, "I'm not a fan of the new pound coin, but then again, I hate all change." So here's my entry. They say there are three great unspoken rules of life. Rule one, rule two, and rule three. Rules, rules, rules. 2 weeks ago, we thought of the rules of the Ten Commandments and the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and what they uphold and protect for human flourishing. To celebrate the dignity of every human life, to ensure that the rights of everyone, including the poorest and the weakest, are protected and safeguarded. It's a small step from there to thinking about the value and the worth of every person, all made in God's image, and to begin to explore, as we will today, the meaning of being alive, the meaning of being human in God's eyes, what's often called theological anthropology. For maybe in Scripture there's a code, there's a framework for humbly walking the ways of justice and of mercy. There might be a roadmap in the Christian understanding of God's creation of human life, of its sanctity and equality, then melded with the concept of human rights, a roadmap that can help us to find the words to address the violence and the separation wall in Israel-Palestine, to consider the horror of war in Ukraine and the plight of its refugees, and find ways to seek peace through non-violent action. Perhaps we might see its inklings in people such as Dawood Nasser. Dawood and his family are Palestinian Christians who run the Tent of Nations farm, supported by the Church of Scotland, amongst others, on a high hilltop 9 kilometres southwest of Bethlehem, where I visited in June. And what's so special about the farm of Dawood Nasser and his family? The land was bought in 1916 by Dawood's grandfather, when Palestine was then under Ottoman control. And over the past century, succeeding generations have grown and harvested olives and vines and fruit over 100 acres. But their problem is that in the past 30 years, they have been caught right in the middle of a political and military storm to do with the occupation of the land by the State of Israel. They live in a place of such tension, of great complexity and terrible violence, as seen in the last few weeks in Gaza and only yesterday in a bus attack in Jerusalem. Peace for everyone in their land is far distant. They exemplify the injustice right across Israel-Palestine, but also an amazing and inspiring response based on their love of Jesus Christ and his teachings. Despite being recognized under international law as Palestinian land in any two-state solution, in 1991, the whole area around the farm on the West Bank was declared to be state land, and anyone disputing this had to produce evidence of ownership. That was near impossible for most Palestinians, but the Nassers happened to have documents and plans going back for 100 years. And for the past 32 years, they have been stuck in the Israeli court system, all the way to the Supreme Court and back at vast cost, looking to prevent their eviction and obtain a court order that they have a right to remain there. The case is still pending. The courts cannot declare that they are not the owners, but they will not declare that they are. And why are they wanted out? Why does the state want them to leave? The farm is now surrounded by five large Israeli hilltop towns known as settlements and a religious school. The state has wanted the Nassers out for the past 30 years so that they can have complete control of the area, both socially and militarily. But the Nassers will not leave, for Palestinian Arabs have a deep connection with the land itself. It defines them in many ways. They will not leave despite their entrance roads being blocked by boulders, their electricity and water supply being cut off, now relying on solar power and rainwater, hundreds of mature fruit trees being bulldozed by the army, patriotic music blaring from the school every time there are visitors to the farm, including us. Despite all this, and being beaten up and put into hospital, and a blank check being offered to them to go, Dawood Nasser says, "We will never sell our mother." Amazingly, under such intimidation, for decades, Dawood Nasser says that as Christians, there will be no violence in response. They will not sow more anger and bitterness in the world. Although they refuse to accept the occupation and the separation walls nearby, he says all resistance must be non-violent. Violence is not the answer. Whether for political or religious reasons, whether in Israel or on the terrible attack this week on Salman Rushdie, the Nasser family refuse to hate. Dawood seeks peace for Jew and Christian and Muslim, for Israeli and Palestinian alike. They refuse to be victims. He says, "We refuse to be enemies." Dawood says they will always be proactive and positive to build a place of peace with international volunteers from all corners of the world to work on the farm, a kids' summer camp and a women's empowerment program. He says, "We will resist and overcome the challenges, not with negativity, but with positivity. Rather than telling the other he is wrong, we will help the other to discover by our loving and peacemaking actions that he might be wrong." The Christian perspective of respecting the dignity, sanctity, and equality of all human life created in the image of God, of recognizing human rights to life, liberty, and security, could not be better illustrated. In our rich diversity as people, what do we all have in common? Well, at our very basic level, we have our humanity. We all live and breathe the same air as human beings. As Gillian read for us, the psalmist in Psalm 8 asks of God, "When I look at the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, what are human beings that you are mindful of them? What are mortals that you care for them?" An age-old question. Why God? Why humanity and why this earth? What can it mean to be human? Does Christianity have any distinctive account of what that might be? Why do us humans have self-regarding notions of human rights, of equality and freedom and liberty, of a right to life and conscience and religion, of due process and justice before the law? From where? Are they just pragmatic for mutual well-being, or is there something deeper going on here? The book of Genesis in chapter 1 at verses 26 and 27, the start of the Jewish and the Christian Bible, asserts that God created humankind, and that he did so in his image, according to his likeness, male and female he created them, giving them dominion over all other animals. So let's investigate some possibilities of what that might mean, to be created as human in God's image, according to his likeness. Firstly, maybe it means a physical resemblance. Maybe it's the classic image of God as a man on a cloud, like Michelangelo portrayed him in the Sistine Chapel on the front of the Order of Service. A man on a cloud with a big white beard with human qualities. Imagery too of God the Father, the Mother, the Son. Yes, God speaks throughout the Bible. God is heard moving in the Garden of Eden by Adam and Eve. The Lord shines his face upon us. But does he really look just like us? If it's not a physical resemblance, perhaps we are made in his image in terms of our human reason, our minds, our moral and spiritual capacities. An image of God tarnished after the fall, so that it is only a bare likeness, but to be restored through God's grace. This notion of being made in the image and likeness of God has been dominant in the Western Church from Irenaeus of Lyon in the 2nd century onwards. But does this put too far a value on the human mind and on human reason? Does it do so at the expense of our physical selves, of our emotional and creative sides? And who's to say that an elevated human mind like God will actually believe in him? Or alternatively, how about focusing on being created in God's image in terms of the dominion over the earth and all its creatures that the Genesis passage talks about? That the two sentences in the passage are directly linked. Just as God has dominion and power over us, we are created by God to have similar dominion and power over all of the earth. But here's the problem with that worldview. It's based on ideas of hierarchy. It can lead to God over world, the state over the individual, men over women, humanity over nature, which justifies all sorts of wrongs and oppression, patriarchy, racism, the destruction of the earth. Unless we manage to mirror God's dominion over us as being one of protection and care, and do not see it as mastery or manipulation, thinking that we are created in God's image to exercise power, sounds all too risky. As a fourth option, perhaps it's our human freedom that mirrors God. Some modern theologians like the idea that we are made in God's image to be like him, free and self-determining. We are able to create and mold and shape our lives and our world. Yes, maybe, but there's a danger there too of elevating ourselves so highly that it justifies the obsession in our society today with individualism, with consumer choice, with independence from all others to control our own destiny. Is that not a harm as well as a good? Or fifthly, is our creation by God in his image seen in our capacity for communion with God? That God can freely approach us and we have the capacity to recognize God's presence. That is the little bit of God inside us. We are created for fellowship with God. We can look beyond ourselves like no other creature. To achieve it, to communicate with God. Daniel Migliore, the theologian, writes, "To be human is to respond in free obedience to God's gracious address." So what makes sense to you? How are we created in God's image and in his likeness? Maybe, just maybe, it's a final option that might resonate the loudest with you, accounting for all or any of the others too. Maybe we are created by God in his image and likeness like the parts of the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, to live freely and gladly in relationship with other creatures, human and otherwise, and with God too. Then to be human in God's image is to be a creature in loving relationship with God, with another human as a partner and soulmate, with friends in a community like this, in a neighborhood, a town, or a city, or between religions or nations. Not thinking of the image of God within us as human faculties or power, but as love and common life in relationship with others, mirroring God's own existence and God's relationship to each one of us. We might live then as part of the whole created order, live in dialogue, we interact, we seek peace, knowing the consequences otherwise are that we are blurring God's image. This would be an active image of God, not a state or a condition, but a continuing movement and a goal in our lives. Not static, but dynamic and progressive, incomplete until the life to come, tarnished by wrongdoing. A relational, compassionate affirmation of our bodily, earthly existence. The great reformer John Calvin wrote, "Look upon the image of God in all men, to which we owe honor and love. Therefore, whatever man you meet who needs your aid, you have no reason to refuse to help him. Say he is contemptible and worthless, but the Lord shows him to be one to whom he has deigned to give the beauty of his image." The human being status as God's image bearer means that human existence has a profound sanctity and a dignity, as Calvin said, a beauty in all people, no matter how outwardly disheveled they may be, no matter whether Christian or Jew or Muslim or no faith. And so, in Calvin's words, look upon the image of God in all people, to which we owe honor and love. Maybe that's how God rests within us all. Like Dawood Nasser says, in the oppressed and the oppressor, recognize the image of God in both. Peace for both. Respect to both. Speak out against injustice and oppression, but like Dawood, do not hate or destroy. Like Dawood, confront all the wrongs of this world, not with anger, but with non-violent dignity and resistance. Look for reconciliation and the chance of a common life together. It's all about our capacity to love one another. We refuse to be enemies. That is often the most unspoken rule of life. Amen.
Jesus lived and gave his love to make our life and loving new. To celebrate with him today and drink the joy he offers you that makes the simple moment shine and changes water into wine. And Jesus died to live again, so praise the love that come what may, can bring the dawn and clear the skies, and waits to wipe all tears away. And let us hope for what shall be, believing where we can see. Then spread the table, clear the hall, and celebrate till day is done. Let peace go deep between us all, and joy be shared for everyone. Laugh and make merry with your friends, and praise the love that never ends.
Let us pray. Let peace go deep between us all, and joy be shared by everyone. God of three persons, you made us for relationship. We thank you for the joy we see around us in the festival, for the plurality of accents and languages, for the creative ways peoples are thinking about each other and the world around us. And yet we also notice those who are excluded. We pray for fresh ideas and initiatives to help the homeless, especially those we see on our streets struggling with addictions. That national policy will result in real action and not remain as warm feelings on the page. We ask that the Council puts money and resources into addressing this issue, as well as the issue of addiction. That the different agencies will coordinate their efforts and work productively together. We think of the staff and boards of housing associations and street work charities, including the church's contributions, street pastors, Bethany, and the Salvation Army. Prosper all this work. We pray for young people and families excluded by their relative poverty, squeezed out of areas they grew up in by gentrification and property speculation. For those families whose incomes are so low that their children can't join in with friends, doing sports, or going to clubs and camps. We thank you for the food bank, for the churches that offer cheap or free activities. Continue to prosper the work of the Family Fund, of Sure Start, as well as all those youth groups and uniformed organisations. Thank you that poverty is again in our conversations and our headlines, that it is becoming part of the national discussion. May it again be the focus of coordinated action by the government, by council. May it be a key consideration when policies are made. We pray for those excluded by their poor health, whether physical or mental. Of those we know who are watching at home because they are too unwell to come to church. For friends in hospital, or who are feeling trapped in their own flats and houses. For those coming to terms with life-changing illness, or are finding it hard to adjust to supported accommodation or the nursing home. Let us take a moment to name them silently in our hearts. And as we pray for our own country, we remember those in other countries who are facing even greater challenges. We pray for peace in Ukraine and for a just end to that conflict. We pray for the people of Palestine and Israel. For students in Hong Kong traumatized by the violence they have witnessed or facing prison sentence simply for demanding democracy. We think of journalists and writers, especially Salman Rushdie. For the women and girls of Afghanistan, 1 year after Taliban took power. For the people of Northern Ireland, facing a Sinn Féin government to the south, and political uncertainty, and a difficult future. It seems hard to imagine peace in such entrenched and intractable situations. Yet we know you are a God of hope. Many of us can remember the parties as the Berlin Wall fell and the dancing as apartheid ended. You made us in your image. May peace go deep between us and joy be shared by everyone. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
God, our Creator, your voice called out over the deep and darkness and brought light. Your voice called out over the waters and brought life. Your voice called out and made us in your image and likeness. Your voice continues to call out and bring new hope, new light, and new life for everyone. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with each one of us and with everyone whom we love, this day and forevermore.